opportunities that are presented for the Health and Wellbeing Board as the one statutory body now that has health and wellbeing under its purview, Children's Trust having been stood down by Michael Gove when he was Secretary of State, and children's issues and wellbeing, meaning a home that's not just about safeguarding, but about much bigger themes than that. And then a trailer for the new model of practice that's been adopted across agencies in the world, which is called Supporting Families, Enhancing Futures, about which more in a while. So this is what the 2017 Act has done. It gained royal assent just before the 2017 election, and it abolishes Local Safeguard and Children Board. Now they were, you will remember, set up under the 2004 Children Act, and they were set up as a result of the then government's belief that the existing area child protection committees were very narrowly focused and didn't look at prevention or early intervention or keeping children safe before things get to crisis point. Their founding was also driven, at least in part, by some of those crisis points, not least in that case, the very tragic and horrific death of Victoria Flinger and the Labour inquiry that led to the 2004 Children Act, which itself followed the Green Paper Every Child Matters, which was an 03 Green Paper. The Act abolishes those safeguarding boards, but what it doesn't do is let anybody off the hook in terms of their safeguarding duties, which will remain a legal requirement, it's just that there won't have to be a board. There will, however, need to be a partnership of some sort. Multi-agency safeguarding arrangements is what DfE are calling them. We are wondering about something like the Wirral Integrated Safeguarding Partnership or some such. There will only be three, and the stress in the Act is equal statutory partners. And they are the local authority, which will probably remain the host body, the police, and the CCG element of the health economy. However, if you're a relevant agency, that means you're a school, an FE, college, a nursery, a children's centre, a doctor's surgery, a health provider of any sort at all, mental health trust, or whatever else you are, and you've already got safeguarding duties, they will remain in place. Now the opportunity there is that if you've got a strong core of those three statutory bodies, and then everybody else is at the table because they want to be, and because they take their safeguarding duties really seriously, the chance for a Borough Wide Rural to really move forward on delivering the 20 by 20, on delivering on each other's promises to each other and holding each other to account without the big stick of a legal framework that demands that you're there. That's very much what Eric and others in the council are interested in and enthused about. His line being, if you force people to the table because it's a statutory requirement, sometimes they come unwillingly. If you bring them to the table because goodwill pertains and people want to do the best for children and people, you get further. And I think there's a lot to commend in that. There will be change to the Child Death Overview Panel system and the sudden and unexpected death in childhood arrangements, in that they will move at national level from the DfE into the Department for Health, and at local and regional levels, we expect the strengthening of the Child Death Overview Panel, currently chaired by my group on a partner's side basis, but the oversight will be with health. Nobody's saying where the money's coming from, nobody's saying whether we're just going to stand it one down elsewhere and expect us to do it on fresh air, because very sadly, some of these arrangements have been played back to the sector. There's been a very heavy consultation and about 800 responses, and it's been played back to the sector along the lines of, well, you decide. Now, there are strengths in that. You tailor what you do to your place. Of course you do. And you do so very strongly in a place that has an identity as strongly grown. The danger in it is that when you expect 1,000 flowers to bloom, have no idea how uniformly planted those flowers are or whether they're all going to grow. And if there is then a horror that occurs, like Tony Cunier or Daniel Felker or whoever else, will there then have to be a scramble to try and reconfigure things? And we don't know. But the child death arrangement timetable. We were hoping that there would be parliamentary debate on the results of the consultation on new Working Together to Safeguard Children draft guidelines that were issued last year in February. But unfortunately, the parliamentary timetable is very heavy at the moment, for obvious reasons, and therefore it will be at least May or June 2018 for full parliamentary debate and full parliamentary sign-off of the new document, which will then be a statutory framework, as the previous version has been. Following that deadline, that's the kind of waving the starting flag. And there will be 12 to 15 months, we think closer to 15 than 12, to put in place the new arrangements and to stand down the local Safeguarding Children Board as it currently operates in order to reconfigure and to create this new partnership. Many partners around the local Safeguarding Board table in the Wirral feel that we may take our eye off the ball if we go into radical, full-scale health and other change. Very particularly, health provider sector groups are saying we are taking our eye off the very important goal of getting better at safeguarding our children together as a partnership. But the DfE have made it very clear that they will not accept new arrangements with just the label changed and the arrangements themselves representing the status quo. Not from any local safeguarding board, that's certainly not from one that was declared inadequate. So there will need to be change. What partners are leaning towards is the least possible change, the least possible disruption that we can manage in the world. Until the new arrangement is in place, the LSCB remains the statutory body, which means that if it all stops on March the 31st, that's the date on which the LSCB closes down, and when everybody gets up on April the 1st, that's the point at which the new partnership takes over. There is no gap. So, here are some opportunities. I'm going to just pass round. I'm involved in a variety of places, and one of them is Roll Room. And they've worked with their children and young people in Roll Room to do a reimagining exercise. They took over a derelict or an empty shop in the middle of the town and they did a pop-up embassy for children and people to tell the adults in their town what they wanted from their place. And I think it's interesting, it's in its infancy, but the sorts of things that Leeds has done, the sorts of things that North Yorkshire has done, the sorts of things that Brighton and Hove has done, Lincolnshire is similar, is very strongly about reconfiguring what you do with and for your children and your people by getting them to be your co-creators and your co-consultants, not just the adults who are catching them or parenting. So if we're going to develop a new safeguarding arrangement and there are only three statutory partners, who else sits in the next layer out from those three, and the next layer out from that, and the next layer out from that? And how do you, as a borough, and all the partners in it, create a child-friendly Wirral that will automatically work to keep its children safe, but also educated and healthy and active new citizens who are less likely to be troublesome or challenging, troubled or challenged, because the borough works together to make sure that their lives continue to improve, especially in some of your more challenged and disadvantaged communities where there are obviously intergenerational difficulties in some children's lives that everybody needs to work together to address. Your new Director of Children's Services is a real enthusiast for helping all partners to work together to make Wirral into the best place possible. aim would be that the Health and Wellbeing Board steps into the space that says, we own this, these are our children, the safeguard of partnership is only part of that. The whole agenda for our children and people in school, in college, in children's centres, in communities, in streets, in parks, belongs to us because it's about wellbeing. I think it's a fantastic opportunity. I stand ready to play my part for as long as is needed, but the actual role that I hold will be stood down alongside the board. So one of the really big decisions is, what's the relationship between the new partnership and this board? Who chairs the new partnership? Does it circulate around the three statutory bodies? Does it involve the relevant agencies as well? How do you ensure objectivity? How do you hold to account? And September 2019 might feel like a long way away, but if you think about it, all the new arrangements are going to need to be consulted on. They're all going to have to go through every executive board of every partner agency concerned. The Police and Crime Commission is going to have to get involved. You need to make sure that DfE is not going to send it back and say, no, you're right. You need to make sure that when Ofsted comes to inspect SEN and disabilities, the fact that children and people are part of that doesn't interrupt your development of a new partnership. September 2019 begins to feel a bit like the week next Wednesday, really. So Eric and Paul and Ian Hassel and Simon from the CCG working now, I think, to try to get round the table and work out what a new thing ought to look like and what its relationship should be to this board. And should it be a subset of this board? Should it report to you so that you can actually keep tabs on what's happening for children and people? And if so, what does that look like and what's the governance structure and who manages risk and who pays for it? Who carries liability, and so on. It's complex change, and the same people who are sitting at the board table now, and the same people who sit here, when you're a bit more boring than you are this afternoon, will actually be the people who are trying to do this change all at the same time. So it isn't going to be simple, and it needs to be right, and Eric is really clear, right, not rapid. So he's really keen that we take a lot of time and we go out a lot to talk to people, and we get invited to boards and senior discussion tables in your organisations. Because this has got to be done right, it's got to be done right for children. I'm just going to trail this. As I arrived, this model, Supporting Families Enhancing Futures, the least handy acronym in the creation, which is SFEF, was being developed, guided and helped by Emeritus Professor Jan Howarth, who's been a professor at Wrighting University and is currently, I think, at Sheffield. It's very, very strongly research-based, and it has been developed by a multi-agency team. So schools have been involved, years professionals have been involved, health colleagues have been involved. It is not just social workers sitting in the dark room and coming out of it with a diagram that says, use this. It's been in place since October. And all the agencies that are on the safeguarding board have signed up. It started in child protection, it's moving into child in need, early health, the multi-agency safeguarding board and other practice. It's very strongly about doing with the family, not doing unto the family. So if you were in a child protection conference running with this model, we would be seated in a horseshoe. You wouldn't always seated around a table with piled papers waiting for the family to come in, that everybody enters the room together. And you are all facing a wall that's blinding flip chart paper. And one section is red, the middle section is amber, and the next section is green. And you and the family work together on what's going on in their lives that is so dangerous that it leads to their lives. What since the last time has moved from red into amber, and what since the last time has moved from amber into green? And they are as strong a driver as you are as a set of professionals of what everybody thinks is actually happening in the story of that family. It's very strong on story work, on working out what the family's journey has been to get to a place where they need additional help. There's masses and masses of professional training material. The innovations are very strongly driven by recording and finding a way of celebrating the lived experience of the family, where there are strengths, however few there may be in a family. understand it, we get it. Families are already saying, you think it's moved from amber to green, we think it's still amber, leave it where it is. And it's the family that helps you to decide whether or not things are moving at the right pace, and it's the family that helps you to decide what extra help is still needed. And families have said things like, we're all facing in the same direction, and you've made me look up. Do not underestimate when a family that's in crisis or in difficulty says that. It's a fantastic model, it's getting national notice. People are getting onto the Safeguarding Board website and using it. They're crediting us because it's copyright, but they are using it. So places that have actually got better Ofsted grades than the LSCB in this borough are sending back to me as chair, this is fantastic material, how do we get hold of it, are you offering training? So those are the five key principles that underpin it. You understand, you very deliberately go in and understand the world of the child, and if the child is very young or non-verbal, you can use drawings, you can use symbol assisted communication, you can get them to draw what they think of their family line, you can get them to think about what they want to say. But at the same time, you're there to understand the world of the adults, including grandparents, those who've got special guardianship orders, people who are doing kinship care, extended family members, blended family members. You very deliberately set out to record what the strengths are. Because actually, even families in really great crisis, one of the things that they'll say is, but we know our children. And children will acknowledge that. Where are the strengths, even if they're small, and how do you build on them? You actually engage the families in the change process, and you help them to set targets for what needs to change next, what needs to improve next. And then you measure the change through those regular meetings. Social workers are saying, this is real social work. You can use the Get Great and Care profile as part of the toolkit that you use when you go in to do a SPEF process. And I'm trailing it this afternoon because we'd like to come back and talk to you again when we've done some evaluation. We think it is potentially groundbreaking stuff. When I arrived last January, it was just about to be made to go live. And the reason why you chose to do it was because you didn't have a model of practice. You had this group over here doing it like this, and this group over here doing it like that, and this group over there reinventing something else altogether, and these people over here thinking, I don't know what I'm supposed to be doing. There is now a model, and it's not going away, and training is rolling and constant. And if you get onto our website, you'll find all the materials. You'll find the threshold document for the right services, right time materials that is highlighted in the bottom right hand side of that slide. We think the board has come a long way. It's now very active on Twitter. It puts out materials, it puts out comments, it reminds people that there are important days. So it reminds people of things like Young Carers Day or Young Carers Week or Foster Fortnight or Adoption Week. It's really important that we are out there and present because young people particularly tend to live online. So do follow.